That would be 100 pounds of cue cards. And changes on the prompter can be done with a little whiteout in a pen. Changes to cue cards require whiteout in 10-gallon drums. The most important feature about this prompting system is it's possible to look the camera right in the eye and still see the words. Prompters like this one don't work well in broad daylight, so the cue card's still used. But think about it. When was the last time you saw an on-camera person say more than about 3 sentences at a time outdoors? Newer prompters throw away the video camera and the paper and use computer-generated displays to feed the prompting monitor. These require you to send the word processor words to the prompting company by modem. I like the paper system because it lets me format my own stuff in the way it works best for me. Needless to say, almost any dunderhead can look good with a prompter and a good scriptwriter. But even us non-dunderheads can use them. Not having to memorize a bunch of script leaves the time to get everything else right. I will double the prompter operator's salary. Prompter operators should get special treatment. Ron Scott's a nice guy and good looking, too. I didn't write this.
I am off to make a show. Fell down.
Here's an Acme riddle. If wooden utility poles come from trees, where do concrete utility poles come from? A lot of them come from here. This is Stresscrete in Burlington, Ontario. You probably think you can guess how concrete utility poles are made. You're probably wrong. This is the interior of the pole under construction. The poles are reinforced with long rods called stress cables. Then, steel wire is wrapped around the whole works for torsional resistance. The next step is to install the framework into a mold. The ends of the mold are closed with caps that allow several of the steel tendons to stick through. The components that will make concrete for the poles are stored in overhead hoppers. Several different colors of stone are available for aggregate, depending on the color of pole desired. The concrete is mixed in batches by computer-controlled equipment. An automated hopper in the basement receives precise measures of sand, stone, and aggregate by moving under the various stationary hoppers. The bucket travels upstairs on rails and automatically dumps its contents into a mixer. In the mixer, the required amounts of cement, water, and additives are added. Once a batch is mixed, the concrete is pushed by a large screw to the waiting mold. The poured concrete is neatened up by hand so that the other half of the mold can be placed on top. This is the point where you or I might guess that the pole is all done. Just leave it for a couple of days to cure. Our pole would be weak and ugly too. Kind of shaped like a pole, with the concrete all lumped to one side by gravity. We'd also only be molding a few poles a day, with all that curing time. The folks at Stresscrete have these little problems beat. First, the mold is bolted together. Next, the rods are stressed. The little round chucks on the end cap hold the tension after the tool's removed. The whole kit and caboodle is then placed onto a cradle that spins it. Spinning causes the concrete to pack itself tightly and uniformly towards the outside of the pole. Packing the concrete this way makes it stronger, and presses it smoothly against the steel mold for a nice finish, and it makes the pole hollow, you know, in case you might want to run some wires up inside it. To speed the concrete curing time, steam is injected down the center of the pole. The poles cure in just a few hours this way. Finally, the mold is open. Free of the chucks, the stress cables are detensioned and are now compressing the concrete, making it much stronger. The pole looks finished, but it won't achieve its full strength for 28 days. The poles can be used as they come out of the mold, or several finishing steps can be applied, depending on the customer and the pole. This is a grinder for the 4, 6, or 8-sided poles. It creates a smooth and polished surface. For a rough or etched finish, sandblasting is used. Concrete utility poles have a lot of advantages over wooden poles, especially given the scarcity of 80-foot trees. The poles are perfectly straight and immune to wood rot and wood peckers. These poles by Stresscrete carry a logo that says TEC. They're found all over southern Ontario. Look one up sometime. Where's that? Look up one. It'll probably come as no surprise that a major television series like Acme doesn't just happen. Months of painstaking research is followed by months of careful compilation of data. Some of the ideas are easy to track down, and some never see the light of day. For 4 years, a simple word has dogged the research list. Coffee. Coffee's a suitable Acme mystery. The taste and aroma are elusive, and if you do manage to make a great pot, a little while later, it's garbage. Now, you'd think that finding out about coffee would be easy. After all, it's a major world commodity, and almost everybody consumes it daily. The problem is that coffee is still a bit of a mystery. The Coffee Brewing Center in New York's been cheerfully whacking away at the subject for years, and the results are fascinating. Chemical study of coffee flavor, sampling method for analysis of coffee volatiles by gas chromatography, coffee roasting chemical change, chemistry of coffee. Now, we know that some viewers are just flipping around to see what's on. Loyal Acme viewers don't need to be told this, but for the flippers, yes, there are chemicals in coffee. The same way that there are chemicals in mother's milk, apple pie, oat bran, and naturally, organically grown tomatoes. Everything in the world is chemical, including yourself. Instead of writing nasty letters to Acme, please look up chemical in the dictionary. While you're at it, look up organic. Acme gets very tired of hearing that there are chemicals and things. Okay, I think they got rid of the flippers. Coffee is grown as a sort of a cherry on an evergreen shrub. There are two species of tree, Arabica and Robusta. The two varieties grow in vastly different areas. The Arabica type is grown in locations that are at least 2,000 feet above sea level. And it's true that someone has to pick each cherry by hand. They all mature at different rates, and it takes a year for your basic coffee bush to produce a pound of coffee, a few beans at a time. Robusta coffee is the lower class of the two types, grown from sea level to about 2,000 feet. If you drink instant or Joe's dollar a pound, you're familiar with the Robusta bean. The complicated chemistry of coffee is manufactured in the plant itself, and everything from the amount of sunlight to the altitude affects the exact chemical makeup. Each coffee cherry has a pair of beans that serves as the pit. By the time coffee hits the shores of North America, the pulp and skin have been removed and only the beans remain. This is the Bourbon Coffee Company. You haven't seen their brand in the store, but if you've bought coffee from a specialty store or a good chain of donut shops, you've tasted it. These are Arabica beans before roasting. They're called green at this stage because, well, they're green. Even though everything that will finally become coffee is contained in the green bean, brewing the green bean results in a beverage that tastes like ugh. The various beans are loaded into this hopper that's actually 8 different hoppers. Some types of bean can be blended with others at the green stage, but blending is usually done at a later stage. From here, the beans are moved around the plant by suction. Suction is used at various stages, not only to get the beans from here to there, but to separate stones and little bits of wood. By the time beans reach the roaster, anything lighter than a coffee bean has been removed. The roaster isn't simply a big oven. The roasting is controlled by bringing the beans to a preset temperature and quickly quenching them with water to stop the roasting as quickly as possible. Each type and batch of green beans will have a different roast temperature, determined experimentally. The conditions that the bean was grown under have laid the groundwork for the chemical changes that happened in the roaster. The roasting process creates aromatic oils in the bean, drives off moisture, and causes the bean to swell in size from gases being liberated. North Americans tend to prefer a lighter roast, with the subtle flavors locked in the bean. Other nationalities roast longer, driving more oils to the surface, darkening the bean. Here the beans are being cooled further. Using suction to move them along the way will leave anything heavier than the roasted bean behind. After the beans are roasted, oxygen is their mortal enemy. This explains why coffee is usually vacuum-packed. These little bags are being filled with coffee and nitrogen. The nitrogen displaces oxygen in the air and doesn't react with the coffee. Nitrogen is 78% of the air we breathe, so don't phone in to complain about it in the coffee bags. Quality control of gourmet coffee is done by, well, slurping and spitting. To ensure consistency, the test coffee is prepared by simply pouring boiling water over the grounds. The trays in front of the cups display the green and roasted versions of the beans. Two cups of each are prepared, in case one bad bean has found its way into a test cup. The coffee isn't labeled. Preconceptions can alter your taste and aroma buds. The first step is to disturb the coffee with your nose near it. This lets you judge the aroma. Then the coffee's slurped rapidly. These two guys are not only nice, knowledgeable people, but they have the self-confidence to do this in front of a camera. The complicated nature of coffee explains a lot of the mystery, but it also ensures that much is going to remain a mystery. There are some things we do know for sure, though. Buying beans and grinding them yourself helps beat the oxygen foe. There's less surface area to attack on a bean. But storing coffee in the refrigerator doesn't help. Buy small amounts and prepare it while it's fresh. Extracting the goodies from the bean is best done with water from 185 to 203 degrees Fahrenheit with a fairly short contact time. Coffee undergoes further changes after the flavor and aroma are extracted. And reheating coffee makes it undergo another chemical flip-flop. The best way to preserve brewed coffee is in a thermos or carafe. Usually, scientific proof of a chemical makeup of a substance is done by synthesizing it in the lab. After careful study of the chemical makeup of, say, a protein, researchers finally take all the stuff they think it's made of and link it together in the metaphorical test tube of science. A look through this paperwork is enough to convince you that we're probably going to be crawling a few thousand feet up the mountain to get our coffee beans for some time to come.